So I'm going to talk about the Intelligent Systems Group and the kind of research that we do at UGD. The fundamental question that you might have is, what should an intelligent machine be able to do? So there are three important aspects that help you understand essentially whether a machine is intelligent or not. So the first thing that it should do, it should be able to understand what you say and write. This is nothing but natural language processing and speech recognition. The second thing that it should understand is what it sees, right? And that's the meaning of computer vision research. And the third thing is it should be able to learn and reason with knowledge. And this is the meaning of reasoning and machine learning, right? This is essentially fundamental research in intelligent systems. So we have six faculty working in the intelligent systems area, along with a number of affiliated faculty, such as Professor Gupta also works on artificial intelligence, and Professor Heinz Schweitzer works on computer vision. So there are six faculty, four of them work on natural language processing, and two of them do fundamental research in machine learning. So Dan Moldovan, who is a professor in the department, he works on things like NLP and semantic technologies. Professor Yang Liu, she works on natural language processing and speech processing, as well as things like text summarization. So you're given a large text document, and you're trying to produce an automatic summary of the document, as well as things like social media analysis. Professor Sandra Harabaju, she also works in natural language processing, and her focus currently is on biomedical natural language processing, and she has done actually fundamental research on things like information extraction, information retrieval, as well as semantics and research. And finally, the two researchers, which is me and Professor Nicholas Rodolzi, we work on fundamental research in machine learning, and I work on essentially combining statistical and so-called statistical and relational models, while Nicholas Rodolzi, he works on things like combinatorial optimization and graphical models. So I'll describe, so my talk is actually in 2 seconds. One is about research in NLP, and the second is about fundamental research in machine learning. So in NLP, we are interested in essentially tasks such as question answering, information extraction, doing biomedical or clinical NLP, doing things like essay grading. So we want to replace essentially graders and teachers by automated essay graders. We also do social media analysis because it's a very hot topic, and you can make a lot of money by analyzing essentially social media and selling products. We also do work on text summarization. As I said, well, the problem that we're interested in is we're given a large document, and what we want to do is like develop or find a summary of the document that is explaining. So let me go over each of these tasks one by one. The first task is question answering. So here are some of the tasks that we're trying to answer. Essentially, what we try to do is we try to read the web and try to answer questions such as these. Which country has the largest part of Amazon forest? No answer? Come on. It's a trivia, right? And the answer turns out to be Brazil, right? And essentially what the computer does is it goes on the web, reads this text document, tries to make sense of those text documents, so that's where natural language processing is involved, and finally tries to see what part of these large web is relevant to answering that particular question, and then tries to come up with an answer for it. So it's an extremely, extremely hard task. And as you can imagine, you can make a lot of money from it, right? So do you guys know about a system that won question answering competitions?
Watson.
Okay, IBM Watson, right? So this kind of made a big impact. And Professor Harabaju and Professor Moldovan actually worked on these problems. The second problem that we're interested in is this information extraction problem. And the idea is you take information and convert it into a database that you can search over. So here's an example. Let's say I have some story about Afghanistan. We've been preparing for another test. Things like thousands of people are feared dead, and so on and on and on. And what you do is you take that text and convert it into some form that you can search and infer over. Things like I'm saying, well, there's a disaster type somewhere. The disaster type is earthquake, and the location is Afghanistan, and so on. Right? So once you have it mapped into a database, you can use essentially database queries to answer questions for it. Professor Harbhajan is also working on clinical natural language processing, and the main idea here is to mine clinical notes in order to improve patient care. So clinical notes are typically handwritten, things like progress notes, surgical notes, hospital discharge summaries, and so on. And what Professor Harbhajan is trying to do is she's trying to essentially build profiles of individual patients, right, have a specific medical condition and whether they respond to any medication and things like that. Professor Harbhajan and Professor Liu, they are also working on automatic summarization. As I said, you have these large amount of texts appearing everywhere in the world, right? And what you want to do is you want to generate a short summary of these documents, right? So that you don't have to go over a document, and you can only go over documents that you're interested in. We also do social media language processing, and things like you take these tweets, which a human cannot understand, at least like humans who are older, and try to make sense of those tweets by figuring out what type of emotions this person has. So if the person is depressed or something, right, then you can try to sell them antidepressant drugs. Okay? So essentially the idea here is to make money. Finally, we also do fundamental research in machine learning, and this actually belongs to the data science track. As we know, there is a large amount of big data in the world, and what we want to do is we want to make sense of it, essentially derive knowledge from it, as Andy mentioned, and answer questions using it, and so on. And we know that big data is characterized by three things. The first thing is it has a large volume, right? So it's not measured in like gigabytes, right? It's measured now in terabytes and petabytes and exabytes and zettabytes and so on that we don't know about. It typically has large velocity. So instead of just looking at images, what you're trying to do is you're trying to analyze videos, for instance, right? Where you get like 1,000 videos per nanoseconds, and those techniques should be fast enough to handle things of such complexity. And then we have also have large variety, which is we don't have just one source, but we have essentially multimodal sources. So data can come from audio, video, and text, and things like that. And also, typically data has a large amount of noise and uncertainty. So what we are trying to do is we are trying to build fundamental techniques that not only achieve human level intelligence, but surpass it in many instances, right, on this particular data. And it turns out to be a $1 trillion industry. So there were some colleagues of mine who were working with me as postdocs when we were doing research at the University of Washington. Some of them joined this company called DeepMind. I came here. And these others went there. And today it turns out that last year they sold that company on deep learning, which does fundamental research in machine learning, right? That's zero products.
You enjoyed the company?
No, I wouldn't. I don't work in deep learning, right? But there were some colleagues who were working on it. And maybe I could have joined as an external member, right? But anyway, right? So.
You have to work the rest of your life if you join the company.
So they were doing fundamental research.
No, you shouldn't tell them.
So they're doing fundamental research in machine learning, right? So essentially the industry had no products, right? All they were doing was doing fundamental research. But the beautiful thing about doing fundamental research is that these 30 researchers sold that company to Google for $400 million, right? So now they don't have to do any research in this case. Okay, so here is the fundamental problem that we're trying to solve. Essentially, there is data in the world. What we do is we try to convert that data into some sort of a model using machine learning. And then once the model is built, we throw away the data essentially and try to infer or answer questions or make predictions using that model. Okay? So the two questions that we're trying to solve is what kind of languages can be used to build the model? And the second question that we're trying to solve is how to make predictions faster and how to learn these so-called models or representations from data in a domain-independent manner. So I'm working on essentially field of AI called statistical relational learning. And what this does is it tries to unify essentially first order logic that Professor Gupta works on, which helps us model relational structure, as well as probability theory, which helps us model uncertainty, right? And try to combine the two into a common representation. So the way we do it is we believe that men are logical. So essentially they are based on first order logic, while women are probabilistic. I'm just kidding. Right? And what we're trying to do is trying to marry the two in order to obtain essentially complexity, variety, and volume of data and come up with something called SRL, which is a marriage of essentially first order logic and probabilistic models in order to handle like large systems. Professor Rossi is doing fundamental research on optimization. And so here is an example. On the left, you have a function which is extremely hard to optimize, right, and extremely hard to minimize. And on the right is a function which is extremely easy to minimize. Right? So what he's trying to do, he's trying to approximate the functions which are extremely hard into some functions which are extremely easy to do. Right? And this can help us essentially. So prediction can be actually described as a task in which what you're trying to do is you're trying to figure out the shape of the function that you're trying to use. Right? And so this is what Professor Rossi does. Okay? So that's my presentation. If you have any questions, come talk to me at the end of the presentation. Thank you.